And together, blessed be the name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Answer the altar call. These are the days of Elijah. Come with the news. See what's happening.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses. Trials of famine and fire. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 There's no God like
Let's pray for our leaders, the Mitchells. Amen. Greg Mitchell is recovering from COVID. Amen. Let's believe God for a swift recovery. Amen. The Morales's and the Siakos and the Galvans. Amen. All that God is doing in Prescott, Arizona. Let's pray for the Pillars there. Amen. Those who were there in the beginning and those who stuck it out. Amen. Throughout the years. Amen. Those who gave their lives, their finances. Amen. And that's why you and I are here and why we are saved. Amen. And doing a work for God. Let's pray for the Campos and the Guineers in Cape Cod, Massachusetts. Hallelujah. The Suspanskys and the Kings in Jacksonville. Amen. Can we also lift up my pastor, Keith Sullivan, and Carrie, his wife. Amen. East Rochester, having a service right now. Let's pray that the altars are filled. Amen. Let's pray that their new converts are being helped and strengthened, making good choices. Amen. Perhaps I did not mention your need in your life. Amen. You have a personal thing that you need from God, an issue. And I want to ask you to lift your hand right now. God sees your hand. Amen. And when we all pray, amen, I want you to lift that up before God because he sees your heart. Amen. Whatever you ask in my name, Jesus said, I will do it for you. Amen. We can hold on to that promise. He's a good God. Amen. He's faithful. Amen. Let's also pray for the local needs in the Greece Church, and that is for families to be added here. Amen. God, to help all our new converts. Amen. We need raw conversions. Amen. We need miracles. Let's pray for, amen, a couple folks. Let's pray for Phil and Beth. Amen. Let's also pray for Zach, amen, God, to help him to make good choices. Danny and Stacy, let's pray for visitors weekly to our church, the Greece Church, to become self-supporting. Amen. We're also going to pray for the Beswicks in Chicopee. Let's pray for a Nepalese girl named Kupala who's pregnant with twins. Amen. She asked us to pray for her. Amen. And God would help them in that situation. And Angelo Speranza, Joe Graziano, both are being treated right now for cancer. Let's pray for their treatments. Amen. Elaine and Krista family, who got saved at our Halloween celebration, if that's possible. Can you celebrate the devil? I don't know. Can you? But we were happy when they prayed. They answered the altar call after the movie. They gave their lives to Jesus. They're moving to Greece. Amen. Let's pray for their family needs and the father also, to come to Christ, amen, and come to church. Let's go ahead and all pray together. Let's believe God. If you're listening online and you need a miracle, amen, now is the time to cry out to Jesus, and he's going to help you, amen. Brother David, can you open us up in prayer when we subside, amen? Let's pray, church. God, we love you, God. There's nothing you can't do. You do the impossible, God. Overshadow Kupala, God. These babies inside of her, Lord God. I pray for miracles to that family.
families, God, all that you're doing, Christ. Help us to become self-supporting, Lord God. Nothing is too hard if you give them your out of your reach. God, you can do these things and much more than we can imagine, Lord God, abundantly and exceedingly, Lord God. You are an awesome God. You are a God of miracles. A God of the supernatural, God. Add to this church, God. Move upon our fellowship, God. Move in America, Lord God. Help us, God, I pray, Lord God. And God, cause this COVID to go away, God. All those who are suffering, who are
we thank you,
affected
Jesus,
by it.
We thank you, Jesus, all the trials Jesus, that we're in, but you are Lord, that you are in charge of it all. And if we turn to you, you'll bring good out of all of it. Give us the grace to trust you in the midst of it, and to look to you, and to hear your voice, and to participate with what you're doing here in Greece. We thank you, Lord, that you have a plan, and all we need to do is tie into it. We thank you, Lord. We can trust you to do that by your Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let's give the Lord praise. Amen. We want to take a minute here to greet everyone, make everybody feel welcome. To be in church. Thank you for coming. It's wonderful to see everybody here. Amen. We're going to have a time tonight. And a few announcements for the local congregation. That is on Wednesday, we'll be back at 7:30 for our midweek service. 6:30 is our prayer. Amen. We are going to be outreaching again. And you know how long we're going to be outreaching? We're going to be outreaching until we're done outreaching. We will continue to spread the gospel, go door to door, meet people in parking lots and tell them about Jesus, invite them to the church. There's flyers in the back if you'd like to do a little bit of that yourself. And let's try to fill up all these beautiful blue chairs. Hallelujah. We had one guy come in after an outreach and we had four people. He said, "Where's all the people in the blue chairs?" There was nobody. He thought the place was going to be packed. Well, you know what? That's your job to pack the church out. Hallelujah. Start inviting people here. Pray. Read your Bible. Keep coming to church. Be faithful in the house of God. And God will richly bless you. Amen. We'll be back on Sunday at 10 o'clock for our adult Sunday school. 10:30 is our morning worship. Amen. And let's see what God can do when we're united together, when we link our hearts. We're located in the Toys R Us Plaza right behind Buffalo Wild Wings. Amen, and come and see what God is doing. If you're being blessed online through the preaching and the ministry of this church, amen, perhaps you're not giving yet. Maybe you're not tithing, you're not making any offerings to it, and maybe you don't even come here, but you can hit the link and you can make a pledge or give a tithe, amen, and start supporting this work as you're enjoying the videos. Can anybody say amen? I don't think I've ever said that yet. Praise God. Let's take our own offering here in person, amen. We'll change the order of our service. This is called Continual Offerings. We're studying the Old Testament. Can you put up that picture of the tabernacle? And God told Moses to build this tabernacle a certain way. There was an altar that was outside of it. I don't know if the picture shows the altar there. There's a side view of it. There's what's going on inside. And this is where they worshiped God when they were wandering in the desert for 40 years. And inside was the Holy of Holies, the showbread, and all those kind of things. And when they put it together, it had to be done a certain way. And people were giving to the work. They were offering their expertise. They were giving money. They were giving gold and silver and, the different fabrics that had to be woven. I think it was badger skin on the walls of the fence around it. Here's a laver, I believe they call this. I didn't even look at this too closely. But that's a laver where they would wash, amen, and be cleansed ceremoniously. But the altar was outside, and this is where the bulls and the goats were sacrificed. And God commanded Moses in Exodus 29, now this is what you shall offer on the altar. Two lambs of the first year, day by day, continually. One lamb you shall offer in the morning, and another lamb you shall offer at twilight. With the lamb shall be one-tenth of an ephah of flour mixed with one-fourth of a hin of pressed oil. And he goes into some serious definition about the way that he wanted the sacrifices to be offered. Amen. This shall be a continual burnt offering throughout your generations at the door of the tabernacle of the meeting of the Lord, where I will meet you and I will speak with you. And there I will meet with the children of Israel. And the tabernacle will be sanctified by my glory. So I will consecrate the tabernacle of meeting and the altar. I will also consecrate both Aaron and his sons as they minister to me as priests. I will dwell among the children of Israel, and I will be their God. And they shall know that I am the Lord, their God, who brought them up out of the land of Egypt, that I may dwell among them. Amen. Can I have the usher come forward? And they will know that I am the Lord, their God. So if you have a personal relationship with God, it takes revelation to give into the work, amen, to pay your tithes and offerings beside. Amen. We will continually be making offerings to the Lord, amen, till he returns. Amen. Let's give to the work. God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. This is a continual thing. We always have these opportunities to give and to give into the work. Amen. Day by day, service by service. Let's make Greece Church self-supporting. That means that, right now we're only paying for half of the lights and the rent. Let's believe God together that we can be completely self-supporting and relieve our mother church of that responsibility. So that they can put money into different cities and into different churches. Amen. Let's believe God together for our continual offerings.
Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to participate. We thank you for caring for us so well and requiring so little of us. You have all of us. And that's the way it should be, but we thank you that you've got it all covered. We don't even have to worry anymore about being taken care of because you promised to take care of us.
Thank you for your offering, amen. God bless you.
Blessed be the name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen. We're going to have a great service tonight. Is everyone ready to hear the word of God?
Yep.
Okay. Well, if you would like to read along with us, we're going to be using the Bible tonight.
Oh, really?
And the scripture is Numbers 25, verses 16 through 18. This may seem a little uncomfortable at the beginning here, so I want you to get ready for this, because I'm going to talk about deception and seduction tonight. We see what the initiative looks like. And behold, the woman meets him. We're talking about a harlot who comes out, and she goes after the man and chases him down. See, now I've come to meet you, to seek you eagerly, and I have found you. Proverbs 7, verse 10. Now, we love to feel loved. We want to feel wanted. We desire desirability. Immorality flatters us. And when the woman goes to the man, she said, "Ooh, you're a hunk. Man, you're awesome." She knows exactly what to say to get his attention. It's a seduction. She dresses as a prostitute sometimes. She dresses very scantily clad. Women know it, and men know it. If you dress a certain way, you will cause people to think of you in a certain way. You'll get their attention. Proverbs 7. Commonality. She's loud and wayward. Her feet do not stay at home, it says in Proverbs 7. She's out in the street. She's out in the market. In every corner, she lies in wait. I know everybody's doing it, the kids say. It's very common. And we all realize it's every man's battle, every woman's battle too. But though immorality is loud and proud, and you can find it in every street corner in every person's life, it shouldn't be that way. How about the touch? She seizes him, she grabs him, or she touches his hand. Proverbs 7. The right touch at the right time is like magic. Piety, she might be a religious girl. She might go to church. She says, "I have paid my vows." And she's born again. She told you she's saved. She's pretty. Easy to get along with. Maybe she went to Bible school, Bible college. Maybe she has a degree. I don't know. Sights, the way things look. I've spread my couch with coverings. And that immorality looks so good to people. It's beautiful. It's enticing. It's seductive. Smells. I have perfumed my bed with myrrh and aloes and cinnamon. Proverbs 7. Immorality smells so good. It's kind of amazing what a little deodorant will do. Or some kind of a perfume, or a cologne, or pounds of makeup, and lights and staging or filters on your phone to make you look good. It's adventurous. Come, let us take a fill of love till morning, she said. Isolation. For my husband is not home. He's not going to be home for a long time. He's gone on a long journey. He's took a bag of money with him. Amen. At the full moon, he will come. Seduction's final tactic is the promise of isolation. Nobody sees us. Nobody will know what happens here tonight. We're together under the cover of darkness, far from prying eyes. Nobody knows about it. Many of you will do it on your device, thinking that nobody sees you. You're in private, and this is a dangerous deception. It's seductive. And so some of you might remember Glenn Cluck, one of my favorite preachers. Amen. He said, "The devil has been a thorn in your side." Amen. "And now is the time for you to be a thorn in his side." Amen. You can fight back against the devil. Amen. Let's look at Numbers 25. This is called Harass the Devil. Fight back. Numbers 25. And then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Harass the Midianites and attack them. They harass you with their schemes, and by which they seduce you in the matter of Peor, and in the matter of Cozbi, the daughter of a leader of Midian, their sister, who was killed in the day of the plague because of the matter of Peor." Amen. So I'm going to talk a little bit tonight about immorality and its seduction. But then we need to fight back, amen, and understand what we're fighting against and what we're fighting for, because we need to fight for what is right. Amen. 1 Timothy 6:12. He says, fight the good fight, amen. Lay a hold of eternal life whereunto you were called, and you have professed a good profession among many witnesses. You and I need to have a will to fight. We need to fight against what is wrong, what is evil, and what is deceiving us. We need to have a posture that we're not going to put up with it anymore. We're not going to surrender to the enemy. You have to have a goal in life to win. And when you have that goal in life to win, you need to have a goal in life to win and win big. Amen. Just don't settle for a little bit of dominion, but fight for all of it. Amen. Make up your mind to stop at nothing to receive, amen, from heaven. Everything that God has planned for you, amen. You may not realize it or see it right now, but those promises that God gave Abraham, amen, are extended to anybody who believes, amen. Fighting with God is the ultimate route. And I don't mean fighting against him and digging your heels and say, I'm not doing that. I'm not going to do what you want me to do. I'm talking about letting God fight with you and fight for you. Amen. Because you cannot destroy your enemies on your own. You are a created being. Amen. And you have no power like the demons in hell do. Amen. When you have God living inside of you, you got half a chance, my friend. When you surrender to God and you, amen, begin to fight for what's right, amen, set your will to accomplish what God has in your life, and that is to take dominion, secondly. We need to take dominion in our lives like a soldier who trains for battle or an athlete who spends hours upon hours training and sacrificing other things to hone his skills. Men are like a student who's studying. Amen. Scripture says to study to show yourself approved. So you should be reading your Bible if you want to win the battle of supremacy against Satan, against the enemy. You want to take dominion in your life, you're going to have to figure out what's going on. Personally, you need to take dominion. There's many issues that we face in our lives that need to be addressed before you can manage the enemy. You have to figure out what makes you tick. You have to figure out where your weaknesses are. The holes in your armor, they say, the kinks in your armor. You need to learn about the devil. You need to learn about where he is going to attack you and his strategies. He's not your friend, my friend. He is your enemy. He is out to destroy you. Amen. You fail continually because you don't know him. You don't know how powerful he is. You play around in sin, and pretty soon, amen, you're being condemned because you've been ripped off. You've been destroyed by a perversion or by the enemy who's managing to lie to you, and you're seduced by sin. Our church, we're looking for dominion in our church here. That's why we spend time worshiping God. It's not just a formality, but we worship God because we're calling on heaven. We're giving God glory in that time so that he comes down and sets you up, softens our hearts, issues a declaration to the devil to leave this place. You cannot have me. I'm a blood-bought saint. I'm worshiping God and God alone. And then it opened up your mind so that you can listen to the preaching and let it get inside of you and absorb you and let your life be changed through the preaching. Amen. That's why we do these things. Everything is done for a reason. And then when you become faithful to church and faithful to prayer and faithful to outreach, amen, you will bring our church to the next level. You will bring this place a dominion, amen. People will be talking about us, amen. We're going to see fruit. We're going to see demons cast out. We're going to see curses and addictions broken in people's lives. We will take dominion if you'll be interested in that. And sanctify yourself. Set yourself aside and understand this is no joke. This is not a toy thing. This is not a play thing. Man, but we're playing for the souls. We're praying that God saves people, amen, and saves them powerfully and wonderfully from sin. Amen. Be careful what you watch on the internet. Be careful where you're spending your money. Be careful who you're talking to, amen. Because the devil roams about like a lion seeking whom he may devour. Amen. We need to take dominion and your holiness, your life set aside for God. We're going to build this church up. We're going to, amen, be no joke here in Greece, New York. As a Pentecostal church, we don't need to be afraid of what's going on in our city against agencies of the government or against different doctrines and heresies and different things that are moving in our city. Amen. We don't need to be afraid of mindsets, amen, that will shut us down, that will keep us back from evangelizing, that will keep us closed into the church so that, you know, we don't want to offend anybody, but gives us a boldness that we can go outside of the four walls of the church, that we can street preach when and where we want to, and we can hand out flyers, we can evangelize, we can pray with people in the streets, on the beach, down at the park, amen, and we can claim dominion here, casting out fear, amen. Fear is a real incentive killer, amen. You're afraid to tell anybody about Jesus because of fear, because of the reproach that it brings upon you, amen. You don't need to have any fear, amen. You can step out in faith, and the moment you open your mouth, God will fill it, amen, with words and give you power, and that fear will leave you, amen. Here's the only opportunity that you get to repay evil for evil. Jesus taught us, you know, when people offend you, don't pay them back. Don't try to get your pound of flesh in there. But here, Scripture is inclining us to repay evil for evil or to fight back at the devil and harass the devil. Amen. This is exciting. It seems like Jesus got some kind of a kick out of healing people on the Sabbath day because he knew that that would bother the Pharisees who had everything perfect. Or Jesus would break some of the rules of, you know, getting the wheat on the Sabbath day or whatever. And Jesus would, you know, do things to oppose them because they were so religious. They had, those Pharisees did not know God. They had rejected him. And I believe that, you know, you and I are allowed to get a kick out of it. Amen. You can preach. You can pray with people. You can speak up for God. Although it gets under people's skin once in a while. He fights dirty, so we're going to fight dirty. That's why we fasted the other day right before the election. Amen. Know that he's going to do anything he can to destroy the good that God is doing in your life. He's going to make things blow up before it's time for church. He's going to distract you from pursuing God's will. Amen. With maybe an old boyfriend, an old girlfriend, somebody's going to show up and they're going to, you know, destroy the faith that God is putting inside of you. The devil will lie, cheat, steal, confuse, and deceive you at any expense. Amen. So we can, amen, we can fight back. We can harass the devil. Amen. We're going to look at that shortly. Secondly, if we fight, we'll win. Here's the promise that heaven gives us, the mandate from heaven. And if we don't fight, we will certainly lose. And sin will then cut off God's blessing from our life, from The protection that God has over our life will be removed because we choose to sin. We give ground to the devil and he makes advances on your life. Numbers 25. Now Israel remained in Acacia Grove and the people began to commit harlotry with the women of Moab. They invited the people to the sacrifices of their gods, and the people ate and bowed down to their gods. So Israel was joined to Baal of Peor, and the anger of the Lord was aroused against them. The Midianites harassed them with their schemes. Amen. I want to jump ahead to this thought that I have in my mind. And this came right after Balaam was worried about Israel. They came up like they were going to devour the land and they were in the wilderness. He hires Balak to curse the people of God. Balak comes and looks over and goes and does his thing and takes up his mantra. And he begins to hear from God that these people are blessed. And there's no divination against Jacob. And these people have a covering and a protection. There's no way you're going to curse them. Four times he did this. And Balaam was ticked. He said, I hired you to curse them. And here these four times you blessed them. So it's right after this that the people fail. They're seduced by the women from the country who came out of Moab and especially Midian, the Midianites. They harass you with your schemes. God said these people are blessed, and it's very probable and very likely that the prophet Balak had told them to deceive them through seduction and the harlotry. He sent the women out there to seduce the men. Peor was a unique situation. Amen. Let's talk about the immorality that they got engaged in, where they got trapped. Amen. Harlotry here refers to two items. Amen. That is religiously and then morally. Religiously, they wanted to go to the sacrifices of their demons, and so they would go into their celebrations and their feasts, and they would make their sacrifices and do the religious thing. It was, and God hated those things, and God was disgusted with that because they were his people. It's like they were cheating on him, like adultery. And also, immorally, they began to sleep with the women in perversion. They blew God's mind by sleeping with the Midianite women, having sex outside of marriage. Amen. Harlotry is the illustration of adultery here, improper sexual relations that are associated normally with a husband and wife, amen, in the confines of marriage. I mean, this is the only way that that relationship is going to be blessed, amen, and that is when the couple is married. There's no blessing that will flow into your life without being married or into that family or into those children, without you, amen, marrying, amen, that person that you are engaging in sex with. Even like Jesus, he's engaged to the, he's like a groom right now, and the church is has the element of being the bride of Christ, amen. And when you and I go out and we worship other gods, we follow after, let's say, materialism, or there's other gods, there's other thoughts, there's other religious things and doctrines that we follow. It's like we're cheating on God. You can only imagine how upset or jealous, amen, God becomes when the church gets off track. They follow false prophets. Amen. You go ahead and try. Try cheating on your wife. Try cheating on your boyfriend or your girlfriend. Try cheating on them, your spouse, and see what happens. All hell is going to break loose, my friend. Amen. God looks at this kind of violation. He's extremely offended at what happened. and through the deception of the devil, amen, continually he rips people off of a power-driven life, of a gladness and joy, amen. The devil still uses sex to destroy God's best, even Christians in here, amen. I like to tell people that the Bible is very important. Some of you say it's outdated, it's not relevant for today, but it's an ancient book, I tell them, because of its importance to us, because we have ancient problems. We still have lust problems and immorality and jealousy and racism and hatred and vengeance and drug problems. They had them back then. They have them today. That's why the Bible is relevant for you and I. Amen. Secondly, you see spiritual leaders. They get tempted into immorality. Sometimes you find evangelists and megachurch leaders flaunting with destruction. And what are they doing? They're bringing shame on Christianity. How many people have said that Christianity is a joke? Look at their leaders. Look at the way that they're living. They can't be Christian. Are you serious? Scripture says that the pastor should be the husband of one wife. That doesn't mean one at a time. Amen. Time to be a thorn in the devil's side for a change. Then the Lord spoke to Moses saying, harass the Midianites and attack them. Amen. Get sanctified. Let's talk about the matter of Peor. There was immorality here. Moses is ticked off what started to happen there in that place. A good counterattack would be to not only be religious, but let's seriously believe God like never before. You've heard the old preacher say, the devil is mad and I am glad. Hallelujah. Let's begin to pray, amen. Set your schedule so that you can start a prayer life. Amen. This will assault the devil. This will harass him. This will send him a very sound message that, amen, you are not going to live the way he wants you to. Defy him. Command him. Loose revival in your life and in your city, in your finances. And loose revival in salvation for your church. Amen. The salvation of souls. Amen. You've heard about binding and loosing when you're in prayer. Loosing would be to let things happen. Amen. As the devil has them confounded. And the devil has them all tied up. But you loose them into existence. Amen. As you believe God and in prayer. Amen. Lay hold of that. You may want to begin a regime of fasting from time to time and accentuate or empower your prayers to a different dimension, amen, make them more powerful. And pray, you cannot have these souls in my life, in my city. These are blood-bought. Jesus has paid for them. You can command the devil. I bind you. That means shut him down. He has no authority over you. Take your hands off of these precious souls. Amen. Scripture says all souls are mine. God says they're mine. I've created them for a purpose. They're not your property, devil. And you can speak like that in prayer. Yeah. And command him. Get thee behind me. When he tempts you to sin, the Greek word hubatasso means, you know, you might even have a right to do that. But I'm blood bought, amen, and I'm going to command you to leave my life alone. You can harass the devil in worship, amen. When you lift your hands, amen, you are signifying that you are surrendered to God. And you give him right of ownership and right of way in your life. God inhabits the praise of his people. 2 Chronicles 20, verse 19. The Levites of the children of the Kohathites, they stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with voices loud and high. And verse 24 in 2 Chronicles 20. So when Judah came up to the place overlooking the wilderness, they saw the multitude, and there were the dead bodies of their enemies everywhere. They didn't even have to fight. They didn't have to pull out their swords and their slingshots, but they had the Levites just praise God. And God created ambushes, and you'll see in the story that the enemies fell through worship, through singing. You'd never think that. But it does happen, amen. We need to evangelize. Fourthly, become vocal. Get the word out, man. Witness, give your testimony whenever you find somebody that will listen to you. When I go door to door, I can't wait for the moment when they smile at me. And they say, wow, thank you for coming to my door. Then I take it to the next level. I can give them a testimony about what Jesus has done in my life, amen. And it becomes very exciting. Amen. You can preach to them, take it to the further level, and even pray with them. And then this is harassing the devil. Doing good works is another good thing where you can harass the devil. We spoke last week, there was a sermon I preached on how hell was not created for humans. It was created for the demons and the devils. Jesus talked about doing good works for people. And they said, Jesus, when did we visit you in the hospital? When were you in prison? When were you naked? He said, whenever you did it to the least of these. Those were people in your life, amen. People maybe you don't even know, people that can't repay you. And you do good for them and you help them. That will glorify God. That doing good works is a way of harassing the devil in a way. And forgiving one another. Here's a powerful work. The devil loves it when you're mad at somebody. How many years has it been going on where you never forgave them? You never let them go. You're still holding on to that. The devil loves that. You're not going to forgive them. But the moment you do, it's like you're sending a charge across the bow. The bow, amen. The bow of the ship. This is what I'm doing here, and I'm going to glorify God, and I'm going to forgive that person for whatever they did. Fill in the blank. Judging sin is another way that you can harass the devil. You can let God judge you if you want to, or you can do it yourself and say, you know what? That was wrong. What I just did is sin, and I'm going to judge it, and I'm never going to do that again in my life. And you let God take that off of you. God smiles on the individual who grieves like him. Amen. Who looks at sin and says, this is not good. This is bad. And then you can take something called righteous indignation. That means that you're serious about it. You're seriously mad at the devil. And you want to see something change. Judging sin means first and foremost letting God get a hold of your heart personally. I got to read this to you because this is very exciting. Judging sin is very exciting. It's very powerful. Many of you might have been familiar with this scripture here, number 25. So there's a plague because they're committing immorality with the women there in Midian. And indeed, one of the children of Israel came and presented his brethren and Midianite women. Here's a present. Here's a birthday present for you. And in the sight of the whole congregation, he didn't do it in secrecy. He flaunted this immorality. In the sight of Moses saw it, and everybody, the children of Israel, they were weeping at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Now Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, son of Aaron the priest, saw this happening. Now listen to me. I want you to get this whole thing and soak it in. He rose up from the congregation and took a javelin in his hand. And he went after the man of Israel and into his tent and thrust both of them through, right through both bodies in one shot. Pinned them to the ground. the man of Israel and the woman of Midian to her body. So the plague was stopped among the children of Israel. And those who died of the plague were 24,000. So it's going to be a radical thing when you judge that sin in your life, my friend. It's easy to point the finger and say, that's wrong. Somebody else, you're doing that wrong. But when you do it for yourself, it's like you're driving a javelin through yourself. And you're judging that sin, repenting of specific attitudes. You know they're not good. You see the fruit of them and you're still suffering from that. But when you judge it, amen, those mindsets, you will be free. Killing those things that are opposing God, then you are ready to make righteous judgments. Don't hold back, but fight and harass the devil, because you will glorify God. God is angered, amen, when we're lured into temptation and we fall into sin. Some of you don't fall into sin, you dive head first into it. It's not like you tripped into it. God is sorely disappointed when you and I sin, when we grieve the Holy Spirit. Amen. It saddens God too. Not bringing condemnation, but correction. So the Holy Spirit, his agency or his job, he's going to convict us of sin. He's going to show us. You know, God doesn't get a kick out of exposing that or, you know, trying to make you feel condemned. Look, you're no good, you lousy Christian. But he's there to lift you up. He's here to do something to bring you through and help you, because that judgment that you make upon it will release you, amen, and bring blessing into your life. And it's just correction. Correction doesn't mean rejection or God's done with you, shutting you out. I don't want to see your face anymore. But he wants to correct you so that you can change, so that you can be helped, so that you can glorify God. Amen. God is ticked off at the enemy, man. God commands Joshua, amen, to respond. And we learn from the scripture that the Moabites were guilty with the Midianites, but the Midianites were the ones that needed to be judged because they were more directly influencing and seducing the men in the matter of Peor. They needed to be judged. So God is glorified when we get free of our adversaries. When we get dominion, we get up and above it and over it and past it. He doesn't get any glory when you're constantly falling down. You're constantly getting up. You're falling down. You get up. You fall down. You get up. You fall down. Get up. Get up. Fall down. He's not glorified. He's glorified when you make that choice and you defeat your enemy once and for all, my friend. And we understand there's a personal blessing that is put on Phinehas because of his action. Number 20. When we, as a people, we judge those things and radically judge them, God brings a blessing to that person, to their heritage. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, in Numbers 20, has turned back my wrath from the children of Israel, because he was zealous for my namesake, with my zeal among them, so that I did not consume the children of Israel in my zeal. Therefore say, behold, I give to him my covenant of peace, and it shall be to him and his descendants after him a covenant of everlasting priesthood, because he was zealous for his God and made atonement for the children of Israel. A personal blessing to you and I, amen. And that is, God says, I will give you peace. It's an interesting thing. For such a violent act, God will put something on your life, a blessing of peace, amen, because you rise up and you make those radical decisions in your life. God will bless us when we violently oppose the works of darkness. Amen. When you and I make hardcore stands, amen, God is thoroughly blessed. God is smiling upon you. God is smiling on your life when you make those judgments. Amen. And we defeat the enemy. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes in the presence of the living God. Amen. And perhaps that's you this evening. you find yourself not saved, or you're listening online, you're not a Christian, and you've given yourself over to seduction, you've surrendered to the enemy, maybe you're living immoral, maybe it's not immorality, but you're being seduced by things that are not Christian. You're being lured away from God's plan for your life. And I'm here to tell you that God loves you, died for your sins, and Jesus himself has shed his blood on the cross as a payment for your sin, amen, so you don't have to suffer any longer. Amen. The wages of sin are death. Amen. There's no remission of sins. There's no removal of that sin in your life without the shedding of blood. And Jesus' blood, my friend, was perfect. Amen. He was a lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. He was spotless. Jesus was tempted just like you and I to sin into seduction. But he chose not to, amen. He was 100% man. And he did that, amen. And was the pure sacrifice of God to pay for your sins, amen. Because you and I are sinners. If you would simply acknowledge that you're a sinner tonight, and you would surrender your will to God, amen, he's going to save you and make you whole. Word sozos, the Greek word that means whole. It'll put your life together, my friend. You wonder why you're not happy. You wonder why you make the same decisions over and over again. You fall into that sin. You're lured into it. You're seduced by it because it is a seductive spirit. You've been deceived. And I'm here to warn you, amen, that amen, God's promises are here and they are for now. Amen. God is reaching out to you this evening. Amen. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable hour. And I'm going to encourage you, if you're not saved, you don't want to go to hell. You don't want to live your life this way anymore. You're going to have to make a radical decision to turn from sin and judge that lifestyle that you're engaged in. And you will be free. You're not free yet, my friend. How many would there be tonight? The sound of my voice. You're listening online, or you're sitting here in the sanctuary in a blue chair. God loves you. But you have to make a choice. You're going to have to pray. And the Bible says if you believe in your heart and you confess with your lips, Lord Jesus, you will be saved. You have no guarantee tonight that should you die, that you would be found in heaven when it's all said and done. How many would there be tonight? You're not saved. Lift up your hand. You want to pray. You want to give your life back to Jesus. You're a backslider, maybe. You've been in church. I've been all that. Been done that. Been saved. But today you're away from God. You're making bad choices. Amen. You're failing in your relationship. And you have wasted a lot of time and money. And God is reaching out to you tonight in a specific way. Amen. He's calling your name, perhaps. Whether you're listening online or you're here in the sanctuary, you're not saved. You're backslidden. And you'd like to pray. You want to give your life to Jesus with an uplifted hand. How many would there be? Amen. Let's change the order of the service. Amen. The devil is the seducer. And listen to me. He is not going to settle for you being saved. He's going to do everything he can to distract you, to disrupt your life. But when you make those decisions, amen, at the altar, when you pray, you come forth, amen. The altar is what church is all about, my friend. Because it's here where you can make those choices and you can seal what God has put into your emotions, what you're feeling now. You're agreeing with God. You're agreeing with Scripture. And this is where you make your choice, amen, to fight back and harass the devil. Amen. We're going to open up the altars. We're going to sing a worship song. You're welcome to come forward and pray. Amen. And if you're not saved, amen, you can also come forward and we'll pray for you also.
my joy, my salvation.
It's good to be saved, isn't it?
Amen.
Isn't God good? Amen. Let's go ahead and take this to heart. Amen. Let's harass the devil. Amen. You have opportunity to harass the devil. Amen. And fight back and be victorious. Amen. We're going to go ahead and close. Amen. And we'll see you on Wednesday night. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. Brother David, please pray for us as we leave.
Thank you for your presence here tonight, Lord. We ask that you go with us as we go out. Lead us to opportunities to share with about you and to help people come to know you, Lord, because we know that that the only hope in this mess that we're living in is you.
Mm-hmm.
So we ask that you give us the grace to be your presence in the world, Lord. Go with us when we go, Lord.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you.